Hi there. Today we're going to look at an overview of cellular respiration, specifically as it occurs in eukaryotic cells. We'll cover the overall concept, the pathway or process involved, and the end products. If you've ever watched a sprinting race, you may have noticed that sprinters often start the race slowly and then gradually increase their speed. Why is that? Often, it's to conserve energy until they need it in the last push. But have you ever considered the process involved in energy production? The source of energy use and storage at the cellular level, essentially all of the energy we use to keep our biological processes functioning, is the compound ATP, or adenosine triphosphate. ATP is created by a process called cellular respiration, a process of breaking down glucose into simpler carbohydrates. Cellular respiration happens in two categories. There is aerobic respiration, which occurs in the presence of oxygen, and there is anaerobic, which occurs without oxygen. In aerobic respiration, the metabolizing of glucose and energy production occurs in four stages. 1. Glycolysis. 2. Link reaction. 3. Krebs cycle. And 4. Electron transport chain, sometimes referred to as oxidative phosphorylation. This process results in the production of 38 ATPs per glucose molecule, but it's a very lengthy procedure. The link reaction, Krebs cycle, and electron transport chain aren't present in anaerobic respiration. Glycolysis still happens, but results in the production of lactate or ethanol instead of ATP. So let's break this process down a little. Glycolysis occurs in the cytoplasm without the presence of oxygen. Again, it's an anaerobic process, so it happens in both aerobic and anaerobic respiration. The task of glycolysis is to break a single glucose molecule down into two smaller pyruvate molecules. There are a number of steps in the process, but they can be categorized broadly into two main stages. 1. Phosphorylation, and 2. Oxidation. So at this point, we're left with two pyruvate molecules. Here, the pyruvate molecules are transported into the mitochondria in order to begin the link reaction. This step is sometimes called pyruvate decarboxylation, so you may be able to guess what happens. In the link reaction, the two pyruvates are converted into two molecules of acetyl coenzyme A. During the conversion, carbon dioxide and the hydrogen groups on the pyruvates are removed in preparation for the Krebs cycle. The Krebs cycle begins with a combination of acetyl-CoA and oxaloacetate, which results in a 6-carbon compound. These molecules are then further metabolized to produce still other products. The Krebs cycle is also known as the citric acid cycle. And now we get to the juicy part, the energy precursors produced in the last phase, such as NADH and FADH, enter the electron transport chain. They're converted into ATP molecules by a series of oxidation and reduction reactions that occur with the help of a proton gradient force that is formed during earlier reactions. The electron transport chain occurs on the inner membrane of the mitochondria, and this involves oxidative phosphorylation and chemiosmosis. At this point, ATP molecules are generated from the precursors against the proton gradient. So let's summarize the whole process. Glycolysis results in two pyruvate and two ATP molecules. The Krebs cycle then forms two ATP, 6 NADH, 2 FADH, and 4 CO2 molecules. The electron transport chain then produces 34 ATP molecules by converting NADH and FADH into energy. So here we have a process whereby cells make energy. But isn't photosynthesis also a way of making energy? Yes, but photosynthesis is usually a way to make energy for storage. It's an anabolic process that builds glucose molecules, whereas cellular respiration is a catabolic process where glucose is broken down. So we've been looking primarily at aerobic respiration because anaerobic respiration doesn't have a huge amount more going on chemically. But that doesn't mean it's not useful. Fermentation is a type of anaerobic respiration that's been used for thousands of years to preserve food and create useful things, like antibiotics and alcohol. In plants, both photosynthesis and cellular respiration happen at the same time. And, in fact, before a plant has germinated, the seed gets all of its energy from cellular respiration. Cellular respiration is essential to all life. Now we've learned about the concept of cellular respiration, the pathways involved, and the final products. See you next time.